Very good morning to each and every one of you. And it's indeed a joy and a privilege to be assembled as God's children in His presence to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come, please join in call to worship. We step off the streets away from places of work, shopping malls, billboards, and the news broadcasts to stand before the living God. Our help is in the name of the living God, maker of heaven and earth. We turn away from the world and the patterns of power that too often hurt, trap, and swallows up. We stand before our helper, the God of mercy, who rescues and renews us. We come to this sanctuary seeking the living God, maker of heaven and earth. We present ourselves to the living God who is compassionate and merciful as a living and pleasing sacrifice. The introit hymn is The Bond of Love. Let's join our voices in singing this introit hymn. Shall we say the opening prayer in unison? Maker of heaven and earth, we come from different places with our own place on the journey. Some of us have succeeded and found favor. Some of us have failed and seek reassurance. Some of us feel trapped and helpless. Some of us have escaped peril and feel great relief. But no matter what our experience has been, we come here today to meet you in worship. Remind us of your power and mercy. Replenish our courage and vision. Renew our identity as your people. Reinvigorate our holy work in this world. For our help is in your name alone, Holy God, maker of heaven and earth. Amen. Let's worship the living God by singing this beautiful hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
In the garden, God made them nations, great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all things bright and beautiful, all creatures, great and small. Wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. God gave us eyes to see them, and lips that we might tell how great is God Almighty, who has made all things well. Bright and beautiful, all creatures, great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all.
The Psalter for this morning is Psalm 124. Psalter is Psalm 124. Let's read it responsively. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when foes rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us up alive. When their anger was kindled against us, then the flood would have swept us away. The torrent would have gone over us. Then the raging waters would have gone over us. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. We have escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Let's join in the prayer hymn, Sweet Hour of Prayer, Sweet Hour of Prayer. Shall we go to God in prayer? Come. Gracious God, our loving Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with hearts full of gratitude and thanksgiving for your grace, for your love, and your mercies in our lives. Lord, you are sovereign and you are in absolute control of everything that happens in us and around us. Father, moments like this are very precious to us. Moments of encountering the living God, experiencing His love and His touch in our lives. Father, we are so grateful for all that you are in our lives. Lord, we praise you. We worship you. We bow before you in humble adoration. Gracious God, we come into your presence, not with our might or intellect, but trusting in your grace and grace alone. Many a time, Lord, we have wandered away from you. Many a time we have grieved. Lord, we have caused pain. And Lord, many a time we have not kept your precepts. Lord, this morning we ask of you to purge our hearts afresh. We ask of you, Lord, to touch our hearts yet again in a very precious manner. And Lord, heal our hearts. And Lord, forgive us, Lord. And help us, Lord, to experience that grace that comes from you. That forgiving grace which restores us. Which establishes that beautiful relationship with you, Lord. Father, fill us. Fill us with your Spirit. Lord, fill us, Lord, with that Spirit which strengthens us. Lord, fill us, Lord, with that Spirit which, Lord, empowers us to love you more, to walk with you. Lord, to draw closer and closer to you. Lord, to fulfill, Lord, your purposes in our lives. And Father, Lord, help us, Lord, to understand the depths of your love. And Lord, to be obedient to your calling. Father, may your Spirit, Lord, flow through our lives, Lord, into our families. Lord, into our workplaces, across the streets, and across the seas, O Father, so that your love may be radiated, Lord, in various places for your glory. Lord, indeed, we come into your presence, Lord, giving you all the glory and honor. Lord, thanking you for that beautiful word that comes to us at each moment in a still small voice. Father, build our hearts, Lord. Ignite our spirits, Lord. Rekindle us, Lord, so that we might continue to shine forth for your glory. Gracious God, we want to thank you for the faith community. Thank you, Lord, for our church. Thank you, Lord, for the vision and mission of our church. And may you continually, Lord, inspire, Lord, your children so that we would be faithful to this vision, to be your witnesses, to be the carriers of your word, and Lord, to be the community of worship, bringing glory and honor to your name. Lord, if there is someone praying a very specific prayer, wherever they are, from their own places, Father, we pray that, Lord, you would answer those prayers. Lord, you would be so close to them. May your comforting hand be upon them. Lord, may your still small voice speak to them in a very special manner. Oh Lord, we want to thank you, for you are the all-sufficient God. Speak to us, Lord, this morning, even as your servant brings forth your word. May your word, Lord, minister to each and every one of us. May your word bring comfort. May your word bring hope and healing into every situation, Lord, in every single family. We thank you for these precious moments. We just want to commend, Lord, the Methodist Church in Singapore, the nation, the leaders, and all those who are serving in times like this with the sacrificial service in the front lines. We ask of you, Lord, to protect them, to guide them, to guard them. And Lord, may your grace be so close and superabundant in their lives. We thank you for these precious moments. We ask all these things in the most precious and wonderful name of Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. Shall we say the Lord's Prayer? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forevermore. Amen. Amen. Let's bring our tithes and offerings into God's presence. Let's give unto the Lord and worship him. During this time, let's put our voices together in singing, I love thy kingdom, Lord. The scripture for this morning's meditation is taken from the book of Nehemiah, chapter 2, verses 11 to 18. Nehemiah, chapter 2, verses 11 to 18. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out through the valley gate toward the jackal well and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or to the priests or nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let's rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king had said to me. They replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Dear friends, this morning the word of the Lord will be brought to us by our dear pastor, Reverend James Naglin, on the topic, Everyone a Builder.
Good morning, church. It's great to meet you once again through this online service. Let us take this time to hear God's word. Let us bow our head for prayer. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful time of worship. We ask, O God, that as we come hear your word, help us, Lord, to surrender ourselves to this prompting of your Holy Spirit, that we may not only just listen, but respond with obedience. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, this morning we have a beautiful text, a famous character in the Old Testament, much admired, some may say a moral leader, Nehemiah and his mission. Nehemiah, a Jew under captivity, a slave of a Persian king. He must have been a good slave for the foreign king to employ him as his cupbearer. Now, cupbearer is a very important position in the palace, in the king, for the king. It's a trustworthy position. Now, Nehemiah 1 talks about how Nehemiah received a bad news from his brother, who returns from, makes this journey from Jerusalem and brings this news to him. Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 3. "And they said to me, 'The remnant there in the province who had survived the exile is in great trouble and shame. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates are destroyed by fire.'" Now, when Nehemiah heard this news, he was broken. The scripture says that he took immediately time to fast. He sat down and he fasted and he prayed. For this news, this sad news, has broken his heart. Now, the text goes on to tell us that after 4 months, God moves the king's heart, and Nehemiah is on his way to Jerusalem, on his way to Jerusalem, with the king's permission and favor on his journey and mission. We know the story. Nehemiah appears as usual on his daily work before the king, and this time, the king realizes that there's something wrong with Nehemiah, and that must have been a very troubled thing, not only for the king, but also for Nehemiah, because no one comes before the king with troubled face. And so when Nehemiah talks to the king about the sad news that he has received and what he intends to do, not only did the king give him the permission, but he also gives him letters that will help him to prepare the logistics for the mission that he was. So in a sense, the king gave him permission and he gave him his favor, his blessing upon his journey. Now Nehemiah recognizes from the very beginning that God's hand is upon all of this, and that is why that this was possible with the king. Now news about this spread, and soon there were enemies for Nehemiah, people who were jealous. People were against the Israelites. And so when Nehemiah embarks on this journey and his mission, there were people who did not like that God had raised a man like Nehemiah to seek the welfare of the Israelites. You read this in chapter 2, verse 10. And then we come to today's text, verses 11 to 18 in chapter 2. In today's reading, we hear that Nehemiah reaches Jerusalem and rested for 3 days. It's a long journey. Now, after that long journey, he arrives and he rests for 3 days. But he also goes on to inspect the broken walls, the burned gates, the state of the city during the night. He takes a few men. The scripture says he takes a few men. He mounted on the animal, his horse, and he went and inspected the city. He examined the city by night. He kept it in a very low key. He knew that though he had the favor of the king, the permission of the king, the letter from the king, but he also knew that the people were jealous and working against him. So he did not want to draw attention to what he was doing. So he kept it very low key. And so until then, he had not shared what God is doing in and through him to anyone. Verse 12b says, "And I told no one what my God had put into my heart to do for Jerusalem." And then in verse 16 it says, "And the officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing. And I had not yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, and the rest who were to do the work." And as a leader, he chose to keep these things to be announced at a later time, perhaps at the right time. Nehemiah had a very clear strategy of his actions after walking the ground by himself. It is almost like some of the crime movies where the detectives walk into the crime scene and looks at all the evidences. If you watch these crime movies, they have this forensic department which go in, looks at the evidences. And as a detective comes and looks at those evidences, suddenly have these flash visions of what would have happened because of the things, a position. Imagination brings him into what could have happened. Now, that's fiction. But here in this story, I look at the way that Nehemiah inspects and examines the ground. He goes through the valley gate, to the dung gate, and to the fountain gate. These are important locations to show what would have happened and how the people living through these broken walls of Jerusalem. In some sense, I may say that the inspection or the examination by night was to see how and to what extent the destruction has come upon Jerusalem. And after inspecting all this, examining all these things, he seems to be ready to meet the people, to speak to the people. And that is where he shares his pain and as well as his plan to the people. And so, as we look at these verses from 11 to 16, we look at what Nehemiah did arriving at Jerusalem, preparing himself to meet the people and to raise them up for an important task. So I want to concentrate in verses 17 and 18 to draw out some points for us to consider this morning from God's word. I see a movement in verse 17 from sight to plight to pride. Pride, I may say the better word would be dignity in verse 17. Then I said to them, you see the trouble we are in, how Jerusalem lies in ruins with its gates burned. Come let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may no longer suffer derision. Another word for derision would be shame. So Nehemiah seems to bring what he has seen and bring that to the attention of these people who have been living through or in the midst of these ruins. He says, do you feel the pain and the shame? He uses the word, you see the trouble we are in. You see the trouble we are in. This is not about a question about sight. As I said, he moves from sight to plight. He draws the attention of the people to see, when you see these ruins, when you see these broken walls, when you see these burned gates, do you feel the pain? The sight of the ruins and the burned gates cannot be ignored. They have been living in the midst of those ruins. Every day they see the rubbles of the broken walls. They smell the burned gates, so to speak. Have they become used to it? And it no longer affected them. Have they become numb to what they see? And they just live with that. They must have felt terrible living their own land, defeated and powerless. They've returned to Jerusalem, but they live in the midst of these rubbles and burned gates. The only word that I can see is that they live as defeated people, powerless. They've become numb to what they see, and that is very dangerous. This may cause ultimate death. Some time ago, I read that pain is good. Not that I'm sadistic, but when we say pain is good, it gives us a warning that something is wrong. Pain signals that something is not okay with us. When we walk, we hit our foot on something, we feel the pain, we are hurt. Even if we don't realize it there at the moment, later, when the pain comes, we realize that something has happened to that part of the body, be it your feet, your knee, your arms, your fingers, whatever it is. The pain that is caused by the injury draws our attention to do something about it. Pain compels us to do something. So what Nehemiah was doing is to bring to their senses the plight they are in. It seems like when he saw the walls, the broken walls, and inspected them and examined the burned gates, he felt the pain because he knew what a great city, the city of David, the Jerusalem, the Zion ought to be. And so when he saw the people and he saw them, he said, do you see the trouble we are in? First of all, open your eyes and see this trouble. Because if you see this trouble that we are in, then you should feel the pain. And he further brings that to their attention by saying that this is a great city. Because he goes on to say how Jerusalem lies in ruins. I do not know how many of us can feel the impact about this word Jerusalem. But for the Jews, this was a great name, Jerusalem. Peace, the city of peace, the city of the King of David, Zion, the center of all that they are as Israelites, the Jewish people, had a great recognition for this place, Jerusalem. And it's now in ruins. The gates are burned, the wall is broken. And so Nehemiah brings to their attention, say, do you see, do you feel the plight that what we are in now, Jerusalem, a great city, now defeated, powerless, broken walls, burned gates. And he go further to say, come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may no longer suffer derision. It's such a shame. We are such a great people, people of God, the people of a covenant God, a God who raised us up to become a blessing to the world. We are supposed to be the example to the world, example tribe, the nation, to show that what God can do to his loving people. That we are supposed to be the city to just draw the attention of the people to say that this is a people of God. We have lost it. We are now in shame. Let us get over that. So he brings them from sight, and then he brings to the attention of the plight that they are in, that they are the low, they are in the lowest end of their lives. The shame, he says, now must change. Let us build that we no longer will suffer derision. Take pride of who we are. You have lost your dignity. Recover the dignity of who Jerusalem is, or who Israelites are, or what Jerusalem ought to be. From sight to plight to pride to dignity. Secondly, in verse 18, he moves from vision to mission. And I told them of the land of the hand of my God that has been upon me for good, and also of the words that the king had spoken to me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for the good work. Nehemiah shared his vision with the people. The day when he heard the sad news of Jerusalem, he had fasted and prayed and sought God's direction. How he had waited for 4 months before God gave an opportunity and opened the king's heart. In this verse, in chapter 2, verse 18, it simply says in one verse, and I told them of the hand of my God that had been upon me for good, and also of the words of the king had spoken to me. Now, I'm sure that he did not just say that one statement and it was over. I'm sure he must have said how he had received those sad news from Hanani, and how he fasted and prayed, and how God stirred his heart and gave him that confidence, that affirmation that God is going to do something about it. And that when the king saw that he had a sad face and inquired about the sadness, and when he shared the news with the king, and behold, the king showed favor, gave him the permission and showed favor on him. And so he shares this story as a way by of a testimony, telling the story of what has happened prior to his coming. And so he says, and I told them of the hand of my God that had been upon me for good. First of all, he recognizes that this is the work of God. He tells the people, look, my friends, I've come because the hand of God is upon me. You know, I was in this foreign king's hand. I was his cupbearer. I have nothing else to do but to do the work of that king, to keep him safe. And when I heard this news, it broke my heart. And therefore, I prayed. And God gave me this vision. And you know what? I almost, with that much of fear and trembling, as I appeared before the king, when the king allowed or gave that permission and showed kindness to me, I got a shock. This must have been the way that he perhaps shared his testimony, because he says, following that, he says, and also the words that the king had spoken to me. Is it possible? It's almost like impossible. He must have shared how scared he was when he appeared to the king. He must have shared how worried he was whether he would be ever given a chance to do something about what he has heard. This was an impossible act of kindness by the king, and this is only possible because God's hand is upon these things. Remember this verse in Romans chapter 8, verse 31. Who then, or what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? Dear friends, the testimony that Nehemiah shares with his people gives them the vision that God had placed in Nehemiah's heart. And so they embark on that mission that he called in verse 17 to say, let us build the walls of Jerusalem. And he said, let us rise up and build. They responded in verse 18 in the later part. So they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for the good work. Let us rise up and build and strengthen and they begin to strengthen their, so they strengthen their hands for the good work. They did not just say that let us build, but they acted upon it, and they got prepared to build the broken walls and the burned gates. Two things I shared with you, verses 17 and verse 18. Verse 17, from sight to plight to pride or dignity. That what they see must disturb their hearts, and that they must work towards recovering the dignity, of recovering the pride of Jerusalem. And then he goes on, Nehemiah goes on to share with them and say, testify to them his vision of how God brought about the impossibility. With man, things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. And he shows, if God is with us, who can be against us? Truly, why would a foreign king show kindness to Nehemiah? Not only kindness, but give him all that was necessary for logistically to support the work that Nehemiah wanted to embark. It's only by God's hand. It's only with God's hand upon this work. And so he assured the people that he has come. In fact, God has sent him, and God is on top of all of these things, and God will take them through. And with that assurance, the people responded and say, and they said, let us rise up and build. And they strengthened their hands for the good work. What should we say? How do we respond to God's word this morning? What does all these things mean to us? How can we respond to God's word in obedience? Firstly, God wants you to open your eyes to see what is happening around you. Are your eyes opened? I want to believe so. The scripture says that Jesus came to recover the sight of the blind, Isaiah 42, verse 7, and many of the other prophetic words on the servant, Jesus, that God will send. It talks about how he will open the eyes of the blind. And I'm sure that we are all seated here as the followers of Jesus Christ. And if you say, I'm a follower of Christ, then your eyes have been opened by Christ. And Jesus says in John 3:3, that truly, truly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So God wants you to open your eyes to see what is happening around you. Your eyes have been opened the day you receive Christ in your life. As a born-again Christians, we know that God has opened our eyes that we may see the kingdom of God. Secondly, God wants you to respond, not only just see, but to respond to what you see and not walk away, not to turn a blind eye, be it for the church, yourself, or for others. If God is showing you something to do, don't go away turning a blind eye or a deaf ear. What does God require of you? What has God shown you? What your eyes have seen? God requires you to respond in obedience. Thirdly, God wants you to take heed of his words. These are the words that you hear Sunday after Sunday of what God has done and what God is doing and what God has promised to do in the lives of his people. You and I come Sunday after Sunday as believers to worship and to receive God's word for our lives, that we may be his children, his disciples, his servants, to love and to honor him and to build the kingdom of God. God wants his people to not only just be hearers of God's word, but doers of his word. Nehemiah shared his testimony and assured the people in verse 18 we read just a little while ago. And the people were encouraged, and they responded, let us build the walls. Let us rise up and build. You and I can respond to God's call to rise up and to build. Each one, in fact, everyone is a builder in God's kingdom. And remember, reminded as I close, the verses in Matthew chapter 13, verses 15 and 16. Let me read those words. "For these people's heart has grown dull, and with their eyes they can barely hear, with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear." These were the words that God spoke to his disciples as he was talking about his parables. And I believe that we belong to the verse 16. "Blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear." We are not people who have sight but don't feel the pain. We are people who have received the word, and we are people who can respond to God's word. And truly, God invites us today to respond to his word. God's church needs you as part of a team that builds the kingdom of God. My dear friends, this morning we can walk away with these words in our hearts and turn a blind eye or a deaf ear and just leave it to others to build the kingdom of God, to be part of the builders, the building team, the kingdom of God. Or we can respond to those words that God has spoken to us by saying that I will be part of God's team in building the kingdom of God. And I hope that you respond to be part of the team. Let us pray. Father, we surrender ourselves into your hands this morning and ask that your Holy Spirit will continue to speak to us and enable us to respond with obedience. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We thank God for the word that has come to us. Let's continue to be obedient to God's word, and let's continue to be walking closely with him to bring glory and honor to his name. In closing, let's sing this beautiful hymn, "O Church of God, United to Serve One Common Lord." Good morning to each and every one of you. Indeed, it's a joy and a privilege to be in God's presence to worship the living Lord. Well, let's take a look at this. Dear friends who are celebrating the birthdays, you can see their names flashed on the screen. May God's blessings be upon these dear friends. And also those who are celebrating their wedding anniversary, may God's blessings be upon them. Let's take a look at the tithes and offerings. Let's continue to worship the Lord by giving in the form of check or internet banking or in the form of PayNav facility. Let's continue to worship the Lord by giving unto Him. Altar flowers. Please take note that you can donate towards the altar flowers, as simple floral arrangement will cost $30 to $50. You can either fill in your names on the altar flower chart in the church or call the church office to confirm your donations. Please also take note that the cost has risen and there are limited flower selections due to COVID-19 pandemic. The church services have been resumed at 8 Short Street from 2nd August. So the service timings are as follows. English service is at 8:30 a.m. and Tamil at 10 a.m. All are welcome. Please register in the link sent in WhatsApp every week. 50 persons are allowed for each service. When unable to register, please call the office at 633-66148 from Monday to Friday from 9 to 6 p.m. Online services will continue as usual. Come, let's recite the memory verse for the month of August. Memory verse. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8. Come, let's receive the benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.